the price of our freedom, and they want all Canadians to share in this understanding. They are passing the torch of remembrance to us, people of Canada, to ensure that the memory of their efforts and sacrifices will not die with them, and that an appreciation of the values they fought for will live on in all Canadians. This ceremony is to commemorate the sacrifices of members of the armed forces and of civilians in times of war and peace.
Thank you.
sauvez-vous, dans le Canada, jamais une page ni le port examiné. Combien par l'air de Pépisville et celle de l'Europe, nous nous souviendrons d'eux. They shall grow not old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. Walter Dowden was a young man of 25, hopeful but practical, as prepared to land with the Allied forces on the beaches of Normandy in June 1944. And he wrote his parent what would turn out to be his final letter. Dear Rogers will share the following excerpt from Lance Sergeant Downing's final letter.
Dearest Mom and Dad, I'm writing this week's letter a day early just in case I don't get the chance to write tomorrow. At this time, I find myself staring into space, wondering what I can write about, what I can say to you folks at home. Much will have happened by the time you receive this. The radio and newspapers will birth forth the news of all the latest happenings as the war goes on, but the radio or the newspapers could not convey to you the thoughts I have at this time. I'm not sure that I can tell you what my thoughts are, or even that I want to tell you. You and I have heard of many chaps who, under circumstances such as this, write very touching letters to be forwarded to their loved ones just in case. I must admit that I thought of it myself, but decided against it. As you know, I'm a very practical person. I'm also a bit of a fatalist, feeling sure that what is to be will be, and that whatever happens always happens for some good reason. Although we may not realize it at the time, I am a part, however small, of a great force which in the months to come will bring the war in Europe to a great and victorious conclusion. It will be hard, yes. I realize that and am ready for it. You may wonder if I'm afraid. I've wondered that myself and have decided that if I do feel any fear, it must be overrun by the other emotions such as curiosity, the will to fight and win, and many other things which I am fighting awfully hard to put words into. Of this, I am sure. I am not afraid of death. I believe sincerely in hereafter and of no regrets for the life I've led on earth. I've had more than my fair share of joy and happiness. I've loved and been loved in return. My friends have had good and many of my experiences in life, although they would not seem important to others, have to me been most pleasant and interesting. So although I do not expect to go to the great beyond until I'm an old man, I'm ready for it when it does come. As for being wounded, well, I thought about that too, and have decided that a hospital could be a most pleasant place if there are many nurses like Ray around. She begins a training period this month, you know. God bless you, Mom and Dad, all of you. Loads of Walt.
The following slideshow is deeply personal in nature. Many students and staff from George McDougall High School have submitted names and photos.
to share a sniper's thought with the name of duty.
After about 15 minutes quiet watching, with my rifle in a ready position, I saw a countless bald man come up behind the trench. The day was bright and clear, and I hadn't the slightest difficulty in taking a careful aim at the very center of that bright and shiny head. But somehow, I couldn't press the trigger. To shoot such a sitter so deliberately in cold blood required more real courage than I possessed. After a good look round, he went down and I argued with myself about my duty. My bald-headed opponent had been given a very sporting chance, and if he were fool enough to come up again, I must shoot him unflinchingly. I considered it my duty to be absolutely ready for that. After about 2 minutes, he came up again with added boldness, and I did my duty.
Traditionally circular, made of evergreen, the wreath is a symbol of eternal life. In laying a wreath, the voices of those long since past are given the opportunity to see a new day and allow their stories and sacrifices to never be forgotten. In memory of the fallen, I would like to invite Mr. Blossom to lay a wreath on behalf of the George McDougall community. them we pledge, amid the winds of time, to carry their torch and never forget. We will remember them.
The 2 minutes of silence we will observe today is a tradition born in a time when the vast majority of Canadians dwell upon a name, a face, or some precious small memory of someone who has served in the military. The 2 minutes of silence is acknowledged at the 11th hour on the 11th day of the 11th month to commemorate the end of World War II. Please take this moment to acknowledge the huge and sometimes ultimate sacrifice that those in service have provided yesterday, today, and in all days to come. Please rise.
I would like to invite Mr. Blossom to share closing remarks.
Ladies and gentlemen, students, staff, today we gather here at George McDougall High School to observe Remembrance Day. It's a solemn occasion that calls us to reflect upon the sacrifices made by the countless men and women who have served our nation in times of war and conflict. This day is a poignant reminder of the tremendous debt of gratitude we owe to those who have given their all in the name of peace and freedom. Remembrance Day is not just about remembering history. It is about understanding its impact on our present and shaping our future. It is about teaching our young people the values of honor, respect, and unity. Now today we honor the memory of brave soldiers who laid down their lives on foreign soil, who endured unimaginable hardship, who carried the torch of freedom in the face of darkness. Their sacrifices serve as a reminder that the pursuit of peace is never without cost. As we remember, we must also renew our commitment to promoting a world where diplomacy and understanding take precedence over conflict. In the face of a world still marked in conflicts, our responsibility is clear. We must instill in our hearts the importance of tolerance, empathy, and the value of peaceful coexistence. We must understand that peace is not just the absence of war, but the presence of justice, respect, and the protection of human rights. On this Remembrance Day, we pay our respects to those who served and continue to serve, and we stand in solidarity with their families. Let us honor their sacrifices by fostering a climate of understanding and compassion in our school and in our wider community. As we took a moment of silence to remember, let us all take a moment to reflect on the power of our collective remembrance. It is our collective memory that the sacrifices of the past fuel the determination to build a more just and peaceful future and community. Those of you who have been present, and I'm going off script now, those of you who have been present for Remembrance Days know that I have a connection and this is an important day for me. You saw the photo of my grandfather, Ari Young. And for many of you who have been at these ceremonies, both here at George McDougall and Muriel Clayton, when I ran them there, I speak of him. This is my day to remember him specifically, and the role that he played in my life, and the role that he played in the world. Now, Ari fought for the Dutch Army during World War II. You know your history, that fight was not very long. He was quickly captured by the Germans and spent a large portion of the war both in a forced labor camp, raising food, helped nourish the German army. And over this past year, spending time with my mother, she shared information that I'd never heard before. I heard new stories about my grandfather, about how he escaped from that forced labor camp, how he made his way across enemy lines, and how he made his way back to his family, and how his father built a secret compartment in the kitchen pantry where he could hide when the German patrols would come to the house looking for him. These types of stories are becoming less and less common as we move further and further from some of those conflicts that have taken place in the past. But we live in a world where conflict still happens, and those types of stories are playing out around the world. This day of remembrance, and Saturday, the actual day of remembrance, is our opportunity to recognize the role we play by remembering those individuals and those stories. stories. Keep them alive. Respect the freedoms that we have and the opportunities that we have. In closing, let us remember, let us reflect, and let us resolve to be stewards of peace. Together, as a school community, we can ensure that the sacrifices of the past were not in vain, and we can build a better world for the generations to come. Before I finally close off, in keeping with my tradition, and I am inviting those after the color guard has been dismissed, and we as a school community are heading back to our learning, I'm inviting you to do what I do. And I'm taking a moment to acknowledge my grandfather, and I'm going to lay my poppy by the wreath. I encourage you to do the same in a respectful fashion if you choose to do so. On behalf of myself, the administration, the staff, and all of our guests, thank you. And may we always remember the brave souls that have given all for our freedom.
Thank you, Mr. Blossom. Please rise for the departure of the Canadian flag.